Hello, today we shall see the building mechanism. So let us first look at the objects of the building mechanism. The building mechanism has three objects. It shifts the position of the strap on the conundrum so that the bobbin is slowed in as the bobbin increases in diameter. So as the bobbin diameter increases, the bobbin has to be slowed down, which we have seen already. So for that, we need to shift the position of the strap on the conundrum. So this is how it is done. This is the rack and this is the pinion. This pinion is a part of the building mechanism which is shown here. And because of the rotation of this particular pinion, this rack will move further on and correspondingly shift the belt on the conundrum. It also reverses the bobbin rail at the end of the lift by bringing the plate bevels into position that would further transfer the reversed speeds to the bobbin rail. The building mechanism also reverses the bobbin rail and this is done with the help of plate bevels, which are seen here. This is the building mechanism and the lower part of this building mechanism, that is the tail like structure that we see over here. This will bring the alternately the plate bevels into position and accordingly reverse the direction of the bobbin rail over here. So this is the second function that the building mechanism has to do. This is how it is done, and this is the passage of speed to the bobbin rail. The third objective of the building mechanism is to reverse, to cause the reversal to take place earlier with each layer that is being built. To build the tapering ends on the on each side of the bobbin, top and bottom, one needs to reverse the bobbin rail slightly earlier with each layer, and that is done by this particular building mechanism again. This is a sort of enlarged view of this particular building mechanism, which the detailed working of this we shall see in the coming slides. So this is the building mechanism, and this is the enlarged view of the same mechanism that is shown here. First, let us see all the parts that are involved here one by one. Once we understand the connections here, then we shall see the working. So at the center A, here at the center, there is a pinion R. We should try and remember what are the various wheels or bevels that are there on this particular center stud here, marked as A. So at the center here, there's a pinion R, which is not seen, which is behind this and shown as dotted lines. This particular pinion R engages with the rack S. Now this is the rack S that is shown here. It engages with this particular rack S. And its other end, that is this I, is in this slide T, which is attached to the bobbin rail. So basically, this particular rack is attached to the bobbin rail, and as the bobbin rail moves up and down, this side of the rack will move up and down. And we shall see how it helps in triggering the building mechanism. So, but then the connection here is that behind this ratchet that is shown here, there is a pinion R which engages with this rack S which is attached to the bobbin rail. So then there is a ratchet wheel, as we can see. This is the first wheel that we can see over here. Behind this, all these pinion R as well as another bevel is also there behind this, which shall engage with this upright shaft here via another bevel H. And this particular upright shaft, you can see there is a pinion U here, which is engaging or drives the rack, and this rack is this one which is going to shift the conundrum bit. So we shall see each one of the parts that are involved. Still there are many more parts here that are involved. So for the time being, with this particular slide, we have learned that on the center boss A, there are three things. That is, one is a ratchet, the second one is the pinion R that engages with this rack S, and there is a third part, that is a bevel, which engages with the upright shaft and drives this upright shaft. So with this, this is the rack S that has been shown. And with this, let us see further on the details of this particular building mechanism. This is your center A that we have just seen. And now the center boss A also has. So we have already seen the pinion that is there, the pinion R, and the one more bevel that is already there. Along with that, there are a few more things that are centered around this A. And One of them is the cradle that is marked as J. This is actually cradle W, and there is another that is J over here. So this is the cradle, the red one is the cradle W, and the purple one is the cradle J that is marked. Both these cradles are independent of each other and they can oscillate around the center A. The rack S that we have just seen in the earlier slide, and also it can be seen here, which actually engages with a pinion R, which is centered around this boss. This S is a part of upper cradle W. That is, this is the upper cradle W, the red one, and it is a part of that. So this is the rack, which is a part of W. So with this, we shall look at a little bit of more details that are there. We also see a chain weight W, that is this W, which passes over a guide pulley P. This is the guide pulley P, and is wound on a bowl K. This is the bowl K that is keyed to the upper part of the shaft B. This is the upper, this is the upright shaft, and the upper part of it, one can see the connection here at K, using this chain here, and this chain passes over this pulley P, and at the bottom of it, there is a weight W that is attached to it. The weight W, as we know, that if it is suspended like this, it will naturally tend to move downwards, and it will try to rotate, and K, this particular K, it will try to rotate, and consequently the upright shaft B, it will try to rotate this upright shaft B in this particular direction, and the ratchet C at A. So all these, once this particular upright shaft tends to rotate, it will try to rotate the bevel that is there behind this ratchet, and automatically it should even rotate the ratchet. But this is prevented by the detents. Now the ratchet, because of the weight, will tend to move, but it is prevented by the detents D and E. This is the detent E, and this is the detent E, D and E over here, which will hold the ratchet and prevent it from any rotation. And these detents D and E are alternately engaging themselves with the ratchet, that we shall see alternate engagement how it takes place. But both these alternately will hold the ratchet and will not allow it to rotate, even if the weight is trying to rotate it. Only at the moment when they are freed, suppose they, at a certain moment or instance, suppose now here E is shown as engaged, and if this were to be disengaged and allowed to release itself, then at that instance only the ratchet will turn because of this weight. Otherwise, it will be held securely and not allowed to rotate. So it will be freed from the ratchet, and the ratchet will be able to rotate due to the weight W. So this we have just explained now. So now our next function, or rather our function, the function of the building mechanism has zeroed down to the rotation of this particular ratchet, because it is being prevented from rotating by these detents. And we must understand that if we want to rotate this ratchet W by any amount, then this one, both these detents must not be engaged with the ratchet, even if it is for some time. So again, let us see, this is the cradle W, the upper cradle, and on the cradle W are two sets of screws A, B, C and D. Now let us see where they are. This is a screw A that is there. Then there is a screw here, B, which is there on the right hand side. Then there is another screw that is C, that is connected via chain to this particular E. Then there is a spring over here. Then there is a cross piece. Then there is again another spring L, and there is a small you can say a screw over here, which is F, which is connected via this particular chain to D over here. So we see A, B, C and D that is connected to the cradle W. A and B release. Now out of these four screws, the screws A and B actually release the pigeon catches X and Y. Now let us see where they are. These are the pigeon catches X and Y over here. These pigeon levers X and Y stop the cradle. That is, they are actually engaging the cradle J, the other cradle that we saw, from rotating due to their engagement with the projection G on the cradle J. So this is the cradle J, which these pigeon levers hold and do not allow it to rotate or oscillate around this central boss A. C and D are connected with special hooks E and F, which I just mentioned. The C is connected with special hooks E and F that are attached to strong springs here, that is K and L. The springs are held by a cross piece. Below it is held by a cross piece, which is marked as M over here, which is fulcrum at O. So this is the entire mechanism that we have seen now. And with this, we are now in a position to see how the building mechanism actually works. So let us see what is the trigger here. The up and down movement of the pin, that this pin is attached to the bobbin rail, as we have said. As the bobbin rail, say, moves up or down, this is the starting triggering moment for this building mechanism. So pin I gives an oscillating movement to the cradle W. Because this pin I on one side and the other side is the this is the rack, which is connected, is a part of the upper cradle W, as we have just seen in our previous slide. So because of this movement, it will actually try to oscillate this cradle W around the center A. So this is the cradle W. And this cradle W, being independent of any other movements here, as we have already mentioned, W and J are independent to move. So W is able to move in this manner in the anticlockwise as well as the clockwise oscillation is possible for it. And this happens as the bobbin rail is moving up and down. The oscillation of W puts either of the springs K or L in tension according to the direction of its motion. So the movement of this W will put K and L into tension as per the movement, which we shall shortly see. So how does the freeing of the detents D and E take place? We have already mentioned that only when these detents, when both are not in position to hold the ratchet and prevent it from rotating, only then the ratchet will turn for a few teeth. Otherwise, all the while they are held by either D or E alternately. So suppose now let us see that the bobbin rail is moving up. Suppose this is the bobbin rail and it is moving up in this direction. This is the cradle W. So the cradle W will tend to oscillate in this fashion in the anticlockwise direction. Screw D shall move up. So since this cradle W has got these screws A, B, C, D, which we have just seen, this D screw will also move upwards. This hook F that the D is attached to, the screw, the hook F over here, will be free from the cradle J. So it will be leaving this cradle J, and it will bring, therefore, the spring L will be pulled and it will come under tension. So the spring L will come under tension. This will be pulled upwards. The other side of the cross piece M, because this side has been pulled upwards, this cross piece M is fulcrumed at O, this particular side of M will be pulled down in this fashion. The hook E, so since this is pulled down, this hook E, which is currently shown as away from this particular cradle J, will slowly come in touch with this cradle J at the top. And a time will come when E will touch this J, and further downward movement of E will be prevented. So it will come and touch this J, and after that the movement of E will be restricted, or it will be prevented. So at this stage there is no other option but this particular spring K, which was not under tension, will now start coming under tension slowly as this end of the cross piece still further moves down, because the bobbin rail has still not completed its upward motion. It has not reached the extreme position. So till then, this entire system is working in this manner, and this K will come under, start coming under tension, and it will be stretched and exert a strong pressure on J. At the same time, as this is being pulled downwards, this E will exert a strong pressure on J and want it to turn, and it will tend to turn the particular cradle here, which was marked as J, and it will try to rotate it or oscillate it around the center A. But as we have seen, a projection on G here on the projection G on J, the cradle J has got a small projection marked G over here, and which is engaged by the pigeon liver X, which we shall just see now. This is J. There is a small projection here marked as small G, and this is the pigeon liver, which will engage itself throughout in this particular J. And even if there is a lot of tension in the entire system because of the upward movement of the bobbin rail here, it will be prevented from oscillating in the anticlockwise direction. When the lifting rail reaches its limit of the upward movement, when this rail will reach the topmost position, the oscillation of the cradle W is set in, it is set in such a manner that this oscillation of the cradle W, as it is rotating in the anticlockwise direction, it will bring this screw A into connection. It will try to press this pigeon lever on this side, or the tail of the pigeon lever. So the upward movement will therefore try to oscillate W in the anticlockwise direction, and it will bring the screw A in contact with the pigeon lever X, and therefore it pressurizes it to release the hold on the cradle J. The tension in the system at this point is so much, we have already seen, that at this stage it produces a quick movement of J in the anticlockwise direction. So J will tend to slightly rotate with a quick motion, and the lower part of J that carries the double finger N. Now lower part of J also carries, it will try to rotate in the anticlockwise direction, and it carries a double finger which is marked as N over here. It, since because of this oscillation, sudden smart oscillation over here, this particular N will give a smart blow to this detent E and try to release it from its position, and E will therefore release the ratchet for maybe a few seconds, or maybe just a few microseconds, we can say. So this detent E will be pushed out of position. As soon as this detent E releases the ratchet, at this instant that this happens, the weight W. Now the weight W was all the while trying to rotate the ratchet, but it was not able to rotate because of this detent E. But now, since this detent E has been released with a smart blow of this finger N, now the weight will act, and it will try to immediately tend to rotate the ratchet C. Through the, of course, the upright shaft and the bevel on the center boss, those are connected. So as soon as this happens, it will try to rotate this particular upright shaft, and because of the connection of this, the bevel that is there on the shaft, it will try to rotate this ratchet. But this happens for only half a tooth. Now the ratchet will try to rotate, but that rotation is not continuous or doesn't happen for a long time, since the other detent D, now we have seen there is another detent over here which is D, it is instantly brought into position by the spring. Now this detent is connected to this other detent E via a spring here, and it connects both of them. Again, the ratchet is not allowed to rotate any further. So as soon as this comes out of position, this spring will immediately bring this other detent D into position and again not allow it to rotate any further. So it is an instant rotation, as we can understand, that the ratchet only is allowed to move around or rotate around half a tooth. So this D, as we see, that spring will bring D into position, and it will not allow any further movement to the ratchet. So during the half tooth rotation of the ratchet, the upright shaft B, that's the upright shaft B, also rotates the pinion U. This pinion U will rotate on the rack, and it therefore further, this rack being in connection with the condrum belt, it will shift the condrum belt. So this is how the condrum belt is shifted. Due to the trigger that it gets from the bobbin rail movement, which is in the upward direction. That's the first trigger that it will get. So the similar action happens when the bobbin rail is moving downward. So quickly we shall see how this happens the other way around. The same action is repeated during the downward movement of the bobbin rail. As it is moving down, the screw B releases the pigeon lever Y. So now is the turn of the screw B, which will release the pigeon lever Y that is engaging with the projection G of the cradle J. under the pressure exerted by spring L causing. So we know that once it, as it is moving downwards, the entire system here, L as well as K, comes into too much of tension. And as soon as this B releases this pigeon lever, it causes this cradle J to rotate in the, now this time it will be in the clockwise direction. And because of that, as we can see over here, in doing so, it releases the detent. So this time when it is the cradle J is rotating in the clockwise direction, the same finger will give a smart blow to detent D, and it will release it, but at the same time, quickly it will bring E into position. But by the time D is gets released and E comes into position, the ratchet is able to turn half a tooth because of the weight. So again, the same thing is happening. D will go out of position and E will come into, will hold the ratchet. This continues throughout the build of the bobbin. So continuously, as the bobbin reel is moving up and down, this will continuously keep on happening. So that is how every time, after every layer, this cone drum belt is shifted because the rack moves further towards the left. So shifting of the cone drum. The half tooth rotation of ratchet C will turn the pinion U and bring about a movement of the rack V that will shift the cone drum belt. So this we have already seen now. So how does the reversal take place? So let us go into that also. Again, the building mechanism is responsible for rail reversal. So in the to and fro motion of the cradle W as we have, we have seen that it oscillates from in the anti-clockwise and the clockwise direction in this manner. So the oscillation that is there, it has been used to give motion to this rod Z over here, which is a sort of tail attachment to the cradle J. And this Z rod is further connected, as we can see, to this particular plate bevels. To and fro motion, or other right and left motion of this Z rod, will bring either of the plate bevels into position, and therefore bring about a reversal in the bobbin rail, which is moving up and down via this particular train of wheels. The pinion R at the center. Now, we remember that there was one more pinion, that is R, which was at the center A, which was engaged with the rack S. And R also will get some amount of rotation as soon as the ratchet turns for half a tooth. And because of that, it causes a movement in the rack S every time the ratchet rotates. And because of that, this alters the position of the pin in the slide T. As this rack will get some movement over here because of the engagement with the pinion R on center A, this I will tend to, you know, move in this slide, which is marked as T over here. And of course, T is attached to the bobbin rail. So this particular movement will bring about the shortening of the traverse. Since each traverse of the bobbin rail, shortens the leverage of the rack above the center A, and consequently the screws A and B will be brought into contact with the pigeon levers earlier at each traverse. So because of this shortening of this particular rack, the leverage has shortened, and therefore now the screws that we have seen, this A and B, will come into contact with the pigeon levers slightly earlier with each layer that is built up, and therefore the reversal is done slightly earlier as compared to the previous traverse. So with this, we have seen all the three functions of the building mechanism. So to summarize, we can say a slide T is attached to the bobbin rail, and the vertical movement along MN controls all the movement. So this beginning is at the bobbin rail and its movement. The shifting of the cone drum strap happens to the upright shaft B and the wheel U. Wheel U moves along the long rack V forward in its slide. The connection of the rack with the strap forks gives the required movement to the strap on the cone drum. So this is the first function. The second effect is obtained by oscillating movement of the cradle J about its center A. This gives a to and fro movement to the rod Z that puts the plate bevels in and out of gear with D, that gives up and down movement to the bobbin rail. So this also we have seen. And the third action is governed by the small pinion A gearing into its rack S. This is R. pinion R gearing into the rack S. The revolution of R moves the rack and alters the position of the pin I in the slide T. And because of that movement of this particular rack, it reduces the traverse. So we have seen all the three functions of the building mechanism. So let us now go to a small topic here where we see the importance of the ratchet that is there in the building mechanism. To understand this, let us consider the following two cases. Suppose the hank of roving is 2, and assuming that there are 120 layers to be filled up for the diameter, full diameter of the bobbin, which is say 5 inches, and the cone drum length is say 30 inches. In that case, movement of the cone drum belt per layer built up is 30 divided by 120. Since we have 120 layers to be filled, and after each layer, the ratchet will turn half a tooth, and that many movements will be required for the belt on the cone drums. So 30, if it is a total length of the cone drum, then 30 divided by 120, that means every time the belt has to shift by 0.25 inches. Similarly, now let us consider another case where the hank of the roving, we have made it finer, say 5. And now we know that for the same full bobbin diameter of 5 inches, the number of layers in the bobbin will increase. Say, let us say it is 160. And let us assume that the cone drum length is constant, which is 30 inches. So in this case, now movement of the cone drum belt will be 30 upon 160. So the cone drum belt has to move in smaller steps now. As we can see, the answer is 0.1875, which is lesser than this. So earlier, the belt was moving more distances with each layer. Now, because the hank has become finer, it has to move by a smaller distance every time so that it is able to complete 160 layers for the same cone drum length and the full bobbin diameter of 5 inches. So with this background, now let us see what is the relation between the teeth on the ratchet and the hank of the roving that is delivered. In conclusion, it is observed that as the output hank becomes finer, the number of steps needed for shifting the cone drum belt increases. This we have just seen. So consequently, since the ratchet wheel turns only by half a tooth after each layer, if more number of shifts are needed for the cone drum belt, we need to increase the number of teeth on the ratchet as the output roving becomes finer. So we can relate this and say that the moment the roving becomes has to become finer, we will have to increase the number of teeth on the ratchet. One thing to note here is that if the ratchet diameter is the same, if I put more number of teeth on the particular ratchet, that means the pitch will be lesser, and therefore with every half tooth rotation, though this half tooth rotation is fixed, the ratchet cannot move more than half tooth irrespective of the number of teeth on the ratchet. So with every half tooth rotation, with a lesser pitch ratchet, the ratchet will be turning lesser, the rotation is lesser. And therefore, the rotation of the upright shaft is also lesser, which results in a lesser movement to the cone drum belt per belt shift after each layer. So therefore, now we can relate saying that the ratchet will have more teeth in case of a hank of roving becoming finer. So with this, we come to another topic here. Another topic in the sense, the same topic, but a slightly modern way of handling the building mechanism, and it is there are some electro-pneumatic methods that are used in controlling or completing the same functions that we have seen. The building mechanism that we just saw was a conventional one, and this is a slightly modern one, the way it is handled by using micro switches and everything. We will just look into that. So first thing that we must know, the difference in this particular mechanism and the earlier one. In the earlier one, we had a hyperbolic shape of the cone drums, which we shall see in the coming lecture. The shape of the cone drum is not straight. The profile is not straight. It is in a curved form. Either the top cone drum is in a concave shape, and the bottom cone drum is convex. So these cone drums are designed keeping in view that the belt is shifted by the same distance per layer throughout the build of the bobbin. But when it comes to the hyperbolic shape of the cone drum, what happens is that it becomes very inconvenient for the belt to shift, because the belt will be shifting over the inclined surfaces, which will be continuously, there is a varying inclination throughout as the bobbin is being built up. So it is the straight profiled cone drums are preferred over the conventional cone drum due to the possibility of a smoother cone drum belt shift. So in the conventional one, as we just mentioned, hyperbolic shaped cone drums, the belt has to always shift over surfaces of varying inclination. Also, hyperbolic cone drums are difficult to design. So because it is these two difficulties with the hyperbolic cones, straight profiled cone drums are preferred. But there is one consequence if we are going to use a straight profiled cone drum. However, the belt in the case of a straight profiled cone drum has to shift through varying distances on the cone drum surface. So in the hyperbolic one, the conventional one, we used to shift the belt by equal distances throughout with each layer. But in case of straight profile cone drum, one may have to shift the belt through varying distances on the surface. So with this, let us see why and how it is done. So this is, let us assume this is the profile of the top cone drum. Slightly an exaggerated view, but it is good for understanding. This is a hyperbolic shape of the conventional cone drum, and so this is a top cone drum, and these are let us say there are 11 shifts that are expected in the cone drum belt as the bobbin is being built up, and let us say there are 11 layers to be built, and 11 times the belt will shift. So the belt will shift in this manner from left to right, and it will move in equal distances till it completes all the 11 layers. Okay, so now let us see in comparison, let us have a straight profiled cone drum. We have taken same length and same width for this, and this profile has been drawn. And now let us say that we are drawing horizontal lines here. This is a top cone drum straight profile. And we are taking again 11 lines where each one of them is cutting the diameter. So if we want the next belt to be in this case at this particular diameter, then this diameter will be achieved in the straight cone drum at this place. Similarly, for this diameter, this straight cone drum will have this particular diameter where at this position. So each horizontal line will represent where the cone drum belt needs to be in case it is a straight profiled cone drum. So now if we draw vertical lines, we can see the position of the belt that it needs to take after every layer. So when we compare this in the earlier conventional one where the shape was hyperbolic, the cone drum shifts were done at equal distances throughout the 11 layers. But the same thing, if we were to use a straight profile cone drum, we see that the shifts are not equal, they are varying, and they are more in the beginning and lesser in lesser distances at a later stage. So with this understanding of the cone drum, we must now come to, we must understand this, that the ratchet itself is not enough to shift this cone drum belt, because now it is no more in equal amounts, it has to be done in unequal varying amounts. So we will need an eccentric along with the ratchet. As shown in the previous slide, the hyperbolic cone drums are replaced by straight cone drums, and the belt has to shift in larger steps in the beginning of the bobbin build and later on in smaller steps or distances. So this is again the same thing that is shown here. This is the hyperbolic profile of the cone drum, where earlier only the ratchet was used in the building mechanism. Whereas the moment you change to a straight profiled cone drum, since we need unequal movement of the belt, we will be requiring an eccentric also along with the ratchet. So therefore, an eccentric or a cam has to be used along with the ratchet of the building mechanism for shifting the cone drum belt. So this is your cam. Let us see how it is driven. And drive from ratchet to the cam. The cam is driven by the ratchet through a set of gears as shown. So if this is the ratchet, if this rotates, then it will, on the same shaft, there is this ratchet change wheel, which rotates this particular, drives this particular wheel, which on the same shaft, there is this particular cam. A half tooth rotation of the ratchet rotates the cam by an amount as calculated by the set of wheels that drives the cam. So whenever this ratchet rotates by half a tooth, there will be some rotation that is seen in this particular cam, and it will be decided by these particular teeth in these gears that are driving the cam. For changing the amount of rotation of the cam, the ratchet wheel 30, this is the ratchet change wheel that is there. One can even change this to bring about a change in the amount of rotation of this particular cam, and it can be, this wheel can be easily changed. So now further on, let us see how this cam drives the belt. So this is the ratchet that is shown here, and on this somewhere there is a cam which is attached via this wire to this particular conundrum belt. The cam further drives the conundrum belt by the wire, this wire, and that is attached to it. The force needed to shift the belt is provided by the dead weight. So on the other side of this, we can see this dead weight, which will help in shifting this particular conundrum belt. A change in the ratchet change wheel, that is, if I change this ratchet change wheel and or a ratchet, or even the ratchet at times may be needed in case of a change of hank of the roving delivered. We have seen that the moment we change the hank of the roving, whether we make it coarser or finer, number of layers in the bobbin changes, and therefore to bring about more or less shifts in the conundrum belt, more number of shifts or less number of shifts, we need to change the ratchet, and either in this case, either we may change the ratchet or ratchet change wheel, or even sometimes both, to allow for finer adjustments. So now with the connections that we have seen, ratchet drives the cam and drive, and the cam drives further the conundrum belt. Now let us look at how the ratchet itself is rotated in the first place. So rotation of half tooth of the ratchet, this is obtained by this particular mechanism that is shown here. The metal brackets 3 and 7, that is metal, this is a metal bracket 3 and this is a metal bracket 7. And also the inclined rods, that is this particular 5 and 7 that is shown here, are attached to the bobbin rail. Now this entire system is attached to the bobbin rail, and it will move up and down along with the bobbin rail. On each up and down movement of the bobbin rail, one of the inclined rods, that is one of this either 5 or 6, depending on whether the bobbin rail is moving upwards or downwards, it will strike this particular micro switch, and it will trigger it, which will emit a pulse. Each pulse further actuates a release mechanism for the detents. So as soon as a pulse is generated, it will actuate a release mechanism for the detents. The ratchet is held by the detent, and it will actuate a release mechanism for the detent that hold the ratchet from rotation. And at that moment, ratchet will turn by half a tooth after each traverse, that is after each layer of rowing build on the bobbin. The inclination of the rod 5 and 6 is adjustable. Now this inclination, we can see there is an inclination in this particular rod. It is adjustable, and it corresponds to the tapered end angle of the bobbin. So if this is a taper angle, then we can see that even this inclined rod is at the same angle as that of the taper that we want in the bobbin. So now why this taper is given, let us see that. After every traverse, the micro switch also moves towards the right. So as soon as the after every traverse, this micro switch is also moving towards the right. Such a mechanism is built up here, where the micro switch will turn towards the right, will move towards the right rather. And every time during the upward and downward movement of the bobbin rail, the inclined rod will come in touch with the micro switch slightly earlier than the earlier layer. So every time it comes in touch earlier, and therefore the reversal that results is taking place earlier. So every time the lift is shortened, and reversal takes place earlier after every stroke. So with this, we have seen two functions already. The turn of the ratchet is therefore responsible for the shifting of the conundrum belt, and also for the tapering ends of the bobbin. Both the mechanisms we have seen. Now the only one mechanism that remains to be seen in this slightly modern building mechanism is reversal of the bobbin rail. So this is again similar to the earlier conventional one, where, as explained earlier, the reversal of the bobbin rail takes place due to the electrically operated valve that pressurizes the left and right chambers of a double acting cylinder alternately. So there is an electrically operated valve that will pressurize this particular double acting cylinder. There's a piston here. It will, once it will pressurize the right chamber, and after that it will pressurize the left chamber. And accordingly, by doing so, it will bring this particular plate, we will either one or two, into position and let it have contact with this bevel 3 over here. Gears 1 and 2 in the diagram rotate in the same direction. The direction of rotation of 1 and 2 is same, whichever fixed earlier, say it is clockwise, then it will remain clockwise throughout the build of the bevel. But it further, because of the alternate bringing of 1 and 2 in contact with bevel gear 3, it rotates the shaft 4. It will rotate the shaft 4 and dry, it will further dry 5, this 7, 6, 7 and then 8, that is the chain which is attached to the bobbin rail. Thus it brings about the up and down movement, because it will every time either of the plate bevel will bring about clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation of this particular upright shaft 3, upright shaft 4, and accordingly it will bring about up and down movement of the bobbin rail. So we have also seen the reversal of the bobbin rail, the way it takes place on a slightly modern roving frame. So just to revise the entire lecture, the building mechanism has three important tasks to perform. First one is to shift the conundrum belt corresponding to the increase in the bobbin diameter. Second is the reverse the direction of the bobbin rail with the bobbin rail reaches the extreme ends in the uppermost and the lowermost position of its stroke or lift. And the third function is shorten the lift after each layer to form the tapered ends on the bobbin. So these are the three tasks, important tasks the building mechanism has to perform, whether it is on the conventional or on the modern roving frame. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.